This is the last lecture before we are going to go on a break, and it's my full intention to complete the presentation on what I call the transcendental apologetics. I'm going to read to you a verse in chapter 21 of the book of the Proverbs, which is very pertinent to what we're going to say today. A haughty look, a proud heart, and I read the New King James Version, and the plowing of the wicked are sin. If you read translations that are a touch more modern, although the New King James Version is a modern translation, but sticks rather closely to the King James Version, when you read a more modern translation, it is a little different. A haughty look, a proud heart, and the lamp of the wicked is sin. Now, the plowing of the wicked is sin. I always like that, because the wicked is doing the plowing. And if the plowing of the wicked, which is a neutral issue, is sin, that would fit in totally with my view of common grace. When I read the lamp of the wicked is sin, I took a close look at the Hebrew. I went to all kinds of dictionaries, and I had to come to the conclusion that that is the better translation. But that fits in even more powerfully, in my view, because the lamp of the wicked is the light of the wicked. Now, the last time we talked together, I received a question about common grace. And what you notice here, that when you take a look at life, it has an antithesis. There's an antithesis between light and darkness. And there's also, ladies and gentlemen, common grace. If you are going to look at the antithesis all the time, you end up in a ghetto, and you are not the salt and the light of the world and the light, the salt of the earth and the light of the world. There's no interaction with your surroundings. If you only take a look at it from the point of view of common grace, it's going to swallow you up alive. Because when James says that which is not from above is from below, it is barren like a rock, it is brute like a beast, and it is devilish like a demon, deadly like a demon, you must come to the conclusion when you look around you, whatever comes from below is all that. However, when you take a look at common grace, you know there's all kinds of skills and achievements and accomplishments. No wonder, because God, ladies and gentlemen, He puts His imprint upon you. So, as I shared with you earlier, metaphysically, we are a reflection of the being of God. Epistemologically, we listen to the interpretation of God. And ethically, we follow the conduct of God, you remember. So when God puts an imprint upon all of it, He gives us being, He gives us rationality, and He also gives us morality. Well, unless we become totally demonic, there are those elements of God's imprint upon the world, and they are awfully copious, all over the place. Wherever you go, wherever you look, you see the goodness of God everywhere. So from God's perspective, you can say thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, all the time, all the time, all the time. Look at the desk produced by an unbeliever, thank you, Lord. You look at the table, thank you, Lord. You look at the world around you, the creation, thank you, Lord. Always thank you for all the good gifts. But from the perspective of a rebel man, it is an accomplishment apart from Jesus, and therefore it must come from below. And therefore, if you read a good book on calculus, as I said the last time, and that's how I concluded. You say, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, because it's a gift from you. But from the person, from the perspective of the person who writes it, first of all, it's stolen goods. He steals it from God. But then he builds it into a context in which he suppresses the truth of God. Because he is not interested. He is an atheist or whatever. And so from that point of view, that same book must nauseate you. Now, we have had a colleague last year, and he says, antithesis trumps common grace. And I think that's absolutely right. Because common grace is nothing but the embalming fluid that keeps a corpse from stinking. And it's special grace that is going to make the difference. Special grace is not embalming fluid, but special grace is the water of life. And I find that when people are so enamored by common grace that that is all they cease to be evangelistic. And that is one of my biggest beefs with that notion. People who never see any common grace at all, they marginalize themselves in the world because they don't have a breadth of view, and they, ladies and gentlemen, are no longer the salt of the earth and the light of the world. So that is what I would like to share with you. Now, when you take a close look at common grace, and people say, well, there is a natural reason, there is natural theology and all that, and there is a common a territory in which everybody agrees. I say, no, 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 no. The unbeliever does not agree with itself among themselves either. You see, because the unbelievers either veer toward the one, the universality, or they veer toward the many, the particularity. And there's an incredible ferocious battle going on between believers, among unbelievers. And so there's no such a thing as a natural theology. There's no such a thing as natural morality in which everybody agrees, in which we build a platform. No. Now, you know that postmodernism goes the universal route, and modernism goes the universal route, and postmodernism goes the particular route. There is a brokenness in the world around you, all right? And so, and that is a culpable brokenness. So the basic category is antithesis, and it's not common grace. Because while God gives it to everybody, even that people do not deal with as they ought to, because there is such a warfare even among non-Christians. Now, when you take a look at the plowing of the lamp of the wicked, the sin, there's a lamp. Don't ever think it's not a lamp, all right? And that's common grace. But it's at the same time a sin. And that is the antithesis. And if you look at the world as a Christian, you say, yes, small letters, no capitals. When it's a yes, you enjoy it. You may enjoy the steak in the outback. You see, that's common grace. Well, when you take a look at the outback from God's perspective, as it is being set on fire by hell, then you say no. If you only say no, you might as well get out of the world. If you get out of the world, if you only say yes, you're swallowed up by it. And that is what I wanted to share with you before I even would move on to the next point. I'm going to pray, and then I'm going to make a remark, and if there are any questions, then we'll handle them, and otherwise we'll just move on to the next point. Let us pray. Our Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus, we ask you that your Spirit will be upon us in this afternoon hour. Illumine us so that what we are talking about is as clear as the day. So that, Lord, when we look around, we look through different eyes upon the world around us. Oh God, give us those eyeballs and let us never lose them. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, why is there such a problem even among Christians who love common grace so that they forget the antithesis, and who love and the antithesis and they forget common grace? Why is that the problem, you see? When it is becomes your eyeball, even among Christians, then it requires an operation, and nobody loves for anybody to touch your eye. You see? So even among Christians, it must be clear that I have their emotions. Because if I think that they don't have any 20-20 vision, they either see a common grace wrongfully or they see antithesis wrongfully, well, then I have to operate on their eyes, you see. And when that is the case, it's not going to be easy. So you got to understand, apologetics is hard work. It requires the totality of your being. Now, again, let me tell you, with great emphasis, that this doesn't fit into your heart, yes or no at the same, your brain, yes or no at the same time. I come back to it again and again if it's in your heart. I mean, if you walk into this classroom and you say, "Oh God, how I praise you for this building and for this classroom," look, and at the same time it makes me vomit. It does. Built by non-believers. See? Now, you understand, I, on purpose, drive the point home with somewhat of an outrageous example. But that is what you ought to do. If you don't say thank you, you're not thankful to God's gifts. If you don't say it makes me vomit, and you don't understand that everything that is produced by man on earth, apart from Jesus, is rebellion. Now, are you with me at this point? You have to go speak loud. Pardon me? The antithesis means light and darkness. Evil and good, yes. From above and from below. Now, are you with me? Because this is going to make a total difference in everything. It's even going to make a difference in your marriage, okay? You're going to look at, you're going to really enjoy, but you're not going to give yourself to it for 100% together with your wife. Well, what if your wife is common grace and you're antithesis? You got to work that out. What if you are antithesis and your wife is common grace? You got to work that out, even with your friends. You see? This is a lifestyle, Mr. Gutierrez. If you only have the one, you're in trouble, you're in trouble, you're in trouble, you're in trouble. And if you put the one differently from the way God puts it, the lamp of the wicked is wicked. Now, I write about it at length in the final note on sovereignty and responsibility. And I would like you to read it very, very carefully. But you see, it is 100% plus 100%, and it lodges very beautifully in our heart. It does not fit into our brain. Nothing, 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 nothing ultimately fits into our brain. Nothing. Yes, ma'am. Pardon me? Why do you have a brain? Well, nothing fits into your fits in your body at the same time. I mean, the universe is so big. God has made us with limitation. But while we do not go beyond the limits of our brain, we use our brain to the limit. Just like a long distance runner. I mean, you hit the wall. Oh, I can't do it anymore. And then you give it one more little push, and you go through the wall, and you say, "Hey, isn't it funny? I'm a different level of experiencing." And then you can run for another 10 miles. But a long-distance runner can never run 200 miles without stopping. It's impossible, you see. But a long-distance runner can run a marathon. could possibly even run two marathons. But he can never run three marathons. Now, if you believe that God fits into your brain, it's tantamount to saying, I can run five marathons. And you go beyond your limitation. Is that... I'm very thankful for those questions because it's so easy to be misunderstood. And as soon as you talk about 100% plus 100%, it's easy to misunderstand, to be misunderstood, because I even have people saying to me after everything is said and done, I said, well, I still do not get it. And I said, what did I tell you? Be thankful for what you get, but don't go beyond it. Are you with me, Ms. Roos? Is it clear? Is it clear? Now, that is the point of contact, the point of rebellion, the point of suppression, not the point of achievement. Well, you may go to the point of achievement, and that's what the Apostle Paul does in Acts 17, you remember? This, you serve a God unknowingly, you know, the unknown God. That's a point of achievement, yes, but it's also a point of suppression. What is deeper, the achievement or the suppression? Suppression. When Peter, I've never said it that clearly. I'm so happy with you. I cannot tell you. My voice is raw. My voice is terrible. But my heart is so happy with you. I cannot begin to tell you, because I don't think that I have ever had a class where this vibrated as much in the souls of the students as this one. I don't think it started out that way, but it gave me a lot of grief. And that's not your fault. I mean, it just didn't start out that way. There's no blame or anything. Prayed about it, and all of a sudden I believe that something is happening, you see, that you begin to see it. And you really get the eyeballs. You do not just pass a test with an A+ or so, but it is much deeper that you come to grips with it. Now you're going to be a lonely people because most people do not have those two eyeballs, 100% plus 100%. And you be very, very careful. I was going to say something and then I got emotional, and I forgot what I was going to say. Oh man, it was so important. Pardon me? How it affects? Who? Marriage. I was already beyond that stage. I was already beyond marriage. I understand that you're still before it, but I'm beyond it. You see, I could never have said that if you were not so sweet. You see, I would keep my mouth shut. I am so deeply thankful that this begins to vibrate, ladies and gentlemen, in your heart. And that deals with the point. I remember the point of contact. Even the Apostle Peter says, repent at the end. But what did he say? You saw that this happened during Jesus' lifetime. All those wonderful miracles. Achievement. You saw it. Stephen, what do you do with it? That's why you have to repent. You get it? So always understand their achievement, their skills. There are all kinds of things. Acknowledge. But it's not the final word. I'm going to be honest with you. I've finished my sovereignty and responsibility, which is my basic philosophy, theology. Then I'm working on my book of James, and you remember that James says that if you fall into sin, it's not God's fault. It's because of something in you, and so that is also part of my apologetics. I'm nearly finished with that. In the moment I have that is concluded, then I am going to go full tilt on biblical apologetics. You already got quite a bit of it, and any encouragement in terms of additions, subtractions, criticisms, or whatever, don't ever hesitate, because I would really like that to be my star work. so that will hopefully make a splash, because while I see many beautiful things going on, even with the wrong methodologies, okay, if God has to wait until everyone's methodology is right, then nothing will happen. So you're always thankful, even in the achievements of your brothers and sisters. Although at one time or another, you may say, you have to say to them, well, there is an antithesis that goes a little deeper than just the achievement, even in yourself, first of all. Yes, thank you, Lord. I have prepared for the class, but I know that I should have prepared better. So the antithesis just even overtakes the achievement at that particular point. And it always is the case in your life. You know why? And the Puritans taught me that you must always have a holy discontent. Holy, you must always be thankful to God, but you must be discontented that it's not better, that you don't go beyond it. So even there, this whole principle holds true, ladies and gentlemen. Well, after having said that, we talked about the point of contact. Now, methodology. I think is the better part of wisdom is I just follow what I have written down, because when I read it again, I felt that it would be difficult for me to say it better than I wrote it down. How about methodology? Well, there are two Achilles heels. The Transcendental Apologetics never wants to go the way of absolute proof, like Sproul does and like Van Til does, nor does it want to go to probability arguments. Absolute proof, ladies and gentlemen, we talked about this at length, not at nauseam, but at length. Absolute proof simply is not to be had by humans. And if you want to make absolute proof, I think you're idolatrous. You try to get ultimate certainty apart from God. Any protest to the contrary. So to go after absolute proof is idolatrous. You know, when I read it again, I thought, wow, that was quite an insight. And I kind of had forgotten it myself again, you see. It's idolatrous. Now, it's very interesting, if I may give you a little bit of a sidetrack. When you take a look at modernity, remember? Modernity is foundationalism. Are you familiar with that term? You give a foundation either in fact or in reason. Well, Hume, in fact, Descartes, in reason. Well, foundationalism is out. Nobody believes in foundationalism anymore, as if there is a possibility of having absolute certainty. If you have absolute certainty, you have absolutes. Well, the funny thing is, ladies and gentlemen, that Christians used all that kind of thinking as the basis of their apologetics. All evidentialism, all rationalism, it just jumped on the bandwagon of modernity. Is there certainty? Yes, the world says, yes, based on fact or reason, we can accomplish it too. Get it? And then postmodernity says, there's no certainty. Guess what many apologists now do? They jump on the postmodern baptism. A bandwagon. There is no certainty. How are you going to handle it? Well, you got to be personal. You got to be warm and fuzzy. You see? I said, folks, doesn't the Bible say that there is no certainty, but not in the postmodern way? And there is certainty, but not in the modern way? It goes beyond it. And so we are taken by the nose twice. First by modernity, and then they failed, and we were as a caboose behind modernity, they failed, and now we run out of gas. And now they begin to go, jump on the bandwagon of postmodernity. And when that runs out of steam, then we are again behind the eight ball. Ladies and gentlemen, do you know what I said in the final moments? And I really get so hot and emotional about it that I'm going to lose my voice if I don't watch out. you see, but that's worthwhile as long as I get it through. If Plato would have ruled the roost, you would have lost Christ. If Aristotle would have ruled the roost, you would have lost Christ. Now, you had doctrine, right? Two natures in one person. Plato said, hey, that cannot be done. So it ends up in one nature. Aristotle says, can it be done? Ends up in two persons. Now, is that where you want to go? Let me see the poison, huh? Huh? Yes, or, oh my God! That's the difference. Mr. J.W., I get sick about it in my stomach. Other people say, well, this is a very interesting academic insight. Yeah, we can, no. Nehemiah had two options. He could have said, oh man, that Jerusalem is in trouble. Oh, look at that, the wall is down. Oh, my. I said, well, I'm very thankful that I don't have that problem because I'm the king's cupbearer and I am secured for my, from the cradle to the grave. I have social security. And I'm the lifeguard, the bodyguard of the king. And my, even if he doesn't smile, the king doesn't kill him, you see, so he must be very close to the king. I said, well, I'm very thankful that I don't have the problem of Latin America and of Africa. You know what I mean? Huh? Right? And you happy, girl? Yeah. Now you're Nehemiah. That's not sufficient. You're on your knees for many days. That's the difference. And then we all stand condemned. That's why I love to go to Uganda. Not because I think they are so superior and all across the board, but because, you see, I am too small a person to fight that whole system in which we are mired down. And the interesting thing is then there are some wonderful people who start a new church, you know, and then people say, isn't that wonderful? It's fantastic. Ew. And I say to myself, yes, it is fantastic, but the antithesis goes deeper than the beauty that you see, even in the Czech Republic. Do you get it, Ms. Roos? Do you really get it? That when the temple was built, the second temple was built, what happened to the folks who saw the first temple? They wept. When I see somebody starting a church, I weep. Why? Because in the days of Jonathan Edwards, there will be a hole in the ground. Get it? Now, in the time of Jonathan Edwards and George Whitfield, starting a little church of, I belong to the Orthodox Presbyterian Church. We started with about 15,000. Now we have 25 or 27,000 after 60 years. See? And we are so happy that we grew. Well, I'm happy. But when I think of the time of George Whitfield, where they would have, where they would start a 5,000 member church in 2 years, you see, and you weep. Now, nobody's gonna like you, Mr. Lee. Nobody's gonna like you. Is he a killjoy? Now, can't you be happy? You get the point? Now, you have to be careful, alright? If I weep, I may be able to get away with it because I'm an old guy, and you may know, but you understand that what people achieve compared to the standard. I feel as if I'm really putting a burden on you, which I do, which you may not totally like, but I hope you will learn to love it. And you always have to be very careful. And now you understand why the Bible is so careful. Rejoice with those who rejoice and weep with those who weep. All right? You may rejoice with your pastor. He is a pastor. I am an elder. And he rejoices. I weep. First you rejoice with him and then you weep with me. 100% plus 100%. And they're both correct. Do you get it? Doesn't fit in your brain. But it fits in your heart. So the notion of absolute proof is really not acceptable. Now, ever since Thomas Kuhn and Gödel's theorem, people have begun to understand that absolute proof is just not in our bailiwick, all right? And besides, absolute proof is always going after the mind as the great prize rather than the heart, as you know. Secondly, probability arguments are also wrong. That is where Sproul and Van Til, who hold out for absolute proof, are completely correct. He said, probability, that flies in the face of God. God says, you know me. You know that I exist. You know. And by the time the apologies are finished, they tell people, well, it's only probable. You get it? God says, Ms. Roos, I exist, and you know it. And then I am God's servant, and I talk to you, and I says, well, I'm happy if I make it probable. And God says, wait a minute. I told you, she knows it. And you tell her it's only probable. Doesn't make sense, does it? Right? You get it, folks? So when you go involved in a transcendental apologetics, first of all, you give a diagnosis. And the diagnosis has everything to do with the dialectic. In the diagnosis, you go one way or you go the other. Ladies and gentlemen, you go veer toward the one or you veer toward the many. You veer to those in authority or you veer to those under authority. Why do you think there are Christians who belong to the Democratic Party and Christians who belong to the Republican Party? I think they have both, if they believe in their party as the final argument and the final answer to the problems, then I think they bought into that dialectic and they're veering one way or another too. And you say to yourself, well, but then you cannot vote for anybody anymore because we are always different. No. Where's the most common grace? Ha, 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 ha. Where's the most common grace? In the Republican or Democratic Party. I'm not interested in talking to a determinate now, but you have to ask that question. And then you're going to make up your mind. Kay Cole says, I vote Republican because I am opposed to killing babies. I was number 6. If my mother would have believed in abortion, she's a black lady, I would never have been here. So I am voting Republican. And then people say, oh, you're a one-item individual. And she says, well, all the black voting is one item, namely, who gives you the most money. You see, that's all we vote for, so don't blame me if you do exactly the same thing yourself. So you ask yourself the question, when you hit upon an issue like this, and you have to make a choice, you don't stay home. That happened in the apartheid. You know apartheid, right? Huh? You're opposed to it, right? Apartheid in South Africa. You know something about that, apartheid? Well, that the blacks were put on the shelf and that they're all totally separate and they got their own townships in South Africa before Mandela took over. That was done also under the pressure of some of the reformed thinkers, which was terrible. But a gentleman in the Nationalist Party, his name was Malan, got it through. And why does he get it through? Because the people were so upset with him that they en bloc, en masse, decided not to vote. And while he had only 35% of the vote, and he would have gone to the government, there's no doubt about it, but because 50% didn't vote, guess what? He got an absolute majority, and he rammed it through. So please, always recognize that you must vote. You must vote, because it's part of your civil duties. All right? But you're going to give a diagnosis, and you're going to answer the way you're going to answer them according to the diagnosis that you have. I write here, modernity typically opts for the one and for authority, since it embraces the universal savior. Postmodernity just as typically thrown in its lot with particularity and comes down on the side of the many and the subject. Unbalanced and naive common grace proponents frequently laud either one of them for its splendid insights and join the fight against the apostate particular in the name of the apostate universal, or vice versa. Isn't that wonderful? Modernity has so many wonderful things to say. Fight postmodernity. Isn't that wonderful, postmodernity? We have so many wonderful things to say. Fight modernity. If you do that, you're already caught in the dialectic. And that is why somebody lamented, why do half the Christians vote Republican and half a Democratic? As a result of it, they cancel each other out in the decision-making process, you see. So you got to understand that. Now, let me ask you, is there something to be said? Is there common grace in modernity? Of course. Is there common grace in postmodernity? Of course. Why? Because even a clock that doesn't run is defunct, is right twice a day. You see? So, if you go after particularity, God made you into particulars, right? So, if you say particularity has a place, yes. And when you go for universality, the classroom, as one classroom, that's the way God made us. So that's something good. But now you're not going to fight particularity in the name of universality, nor are you going to fight universality in the name of particularity. And now you understand also why common grace is just like embalming fluid that keeps a corpse from stinking, because God says to the Republican, calm down. He says to the Democrats, calm down. And everybody calms down, and life becomes much more pleasant. But it doesn't mean that there's a change. A heartfelt change. Change, ladies and gentlemen. And so, if you're going to enlist in a questionable program, one or the many, with questionable objectives, you turn into a tail that is wagged by the dog of an unclean ideology. So you become the tail. What does the book of Deuteronomy say? If you truly obey me. And the issue is not universality or particularity. The issue is sin pertaining to universality, no tyranny, and pertaining to particularity, no rebellion. You see that? You see, it's totally different. And that's what you hone in on in your apologetics. Is it easy? No, it's hard work. But since when is anything that is worthwhile simple? You know, people say the best things in the world are free. Well, that is not totally wrong, because the air is free, but there's also another aspect to it. Okay, so you must function as the head, and you say no to sin, and you say no to sin. You say no to universal sin, and you say no to particular sin. If you say no to universality and no to particularity, you fight God, because God says they're both in the world. Universality is bad. God says, since when? I am one. Particularity is bad. Since when? I am three. Do you get it? So what is the only way you can fight it is by the truth. It's the only liberating cure for a perishing mankind. You can never get anywhere without the truth, ladies and gentlemen. Biblical truth is its core, and then you have rational truth, factual truth, and experiential truth. Do you remember? And I mentioned those three elements. I clustered around it. And how do you get the truth through? Through the Spirit. So you're filled with the Spirit. And don't put the Spirit as a caboose at the end. Please, please, please. After you're finished with all your wonderful statements, then you say, well, if it doesn't work, the Holy Spirit can use it. No, 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 no. Then, in my estimation, you grieve the Holy Spirit. You, ladies and gentlemen, recognize that you're always instruments in the hands of the Holy Spirit. Otherwise, you'll never get anywhere. So you do not just say we are neutral territory, pre-evangelistic, nor do you say, well, we are on non-neutral territory. I talked with my son-in-law about it this morning, and I had a, this was the formulation that I came up with. Evidentialism believes in, is pre-evangelistic and acts in a neutral territory. Presuppositionalism is non-evangelistic and acts in a non-neutral territory. But, and I'm going to find a better terminology for that, but biblical apologetics is evangelistic and operates in God's territory. You see, so you in God's territory with the Holy Spirit. He is the origin of all power, clarity, boldness, love, and effectiveness. Well, what do you want, huh? Get it? And how do you approach it? The gentleness of grace, the precision of a surgeon, and the carefulness of a rescue operation. 2 Timothy 2, 24-26. So, it must be gently, because it's a matter of grace, God must make the difference. The perdition of a sermon, of a surgeon, because you're meticulous in your truth. And the carefulness of a rescue, if God perchance is going to set people free of the wiles of Satan who captures you to do his will. All right? Now, what is the attitude? It must be one of compassion for lost sinners and courage toward rebel sinners. Sinners are both lost and rebels. Well, if you only see them as lost, guess what? Then you become seeker sensitive. If you only see them as rebels, you use them as donkeys who can only be listened to, who only listen when you put a 2x4 on them. You see what I mean? No. It's 100% plus 100% once again. By the time that gets into your system, Laura, you're a different woman. You don't hobble with one leg longer than the other, but you can walk, you see, on both legs. And so, lost sinners, total compassion, rebellion, total sobriety. That's why you must deal with the people as sly as a fox. Does that make sense, Bridget? You must be sly as a fox? And you say, no, that doesn't fit. You must be innocent like a dove. And other people say, you'll never get away. You'll never get anywhere if you're innocent like a dove. What does Jesus say? You got to be innocent like a dove, and you got to be sly like a fox. If you're only innocent, they make mincemeat out of it. If you're only sly, you become manipulative. 100% plus 100% is 100%. Right back again, ladies and gentlemen. What is the procedure? The procedure is negative and positive. What is negative? That is why I ask you to read Zechariah's book. That is totally negative in terms of the reductio ad absurdum. He reduces the views of the opponents, and he shows that they are logically inconsistent. That is one thing. He also shows you, ladies and gentlemen, that they are factually non-correspondent, and he shows that they are personally unsatisfactory. You remember the three criteria that he puts at the end of his book? I think they should never be used criteria, because then you put the truth underneath those criteria. But he shows that the non-Christian is logically incoherent, factually non-correspondent, and personally unsatisfactory, and therefore false, self-defeating, and self-destructive. Well, ladies and gentlemen, you take one look at Zechariah's book, and the one word that towers over everything else is self-destruction. You understand that? Now, why? Is it sufficient? Now, before I say that this is a large part of the agenda of Schaefer, Clark, Van Til, and it is very competently done by Zacharias. However, not too much talk should be placed on imminent criticism. Yes, sir. No. It is self-destructive, because he shows that whole book. What do you end up with? Everything goes by the board, right? And if you say, isn't that fantastic? Zacharias hit the nail on the head. Now, everybody must listen. Now, there he is naive. You see, you read Zacharias, right? And you recognize that he goes through all kinds of chapters by showing that whatever man touches is, it ends up in a terrible fashion, all right? And it really makes you downhearted when you read all that. There's nothing left. I can give you one example. When the postmodern man says there is no absolute truth, and that is the absolute truth. Now, if there's anything logically incoherent, that is that. But are you getting anywhere with that criticism? And the answer is no. And I'll tell you why. Over 2,000 years, as we're going to see, the Lord willing, after the break, when I deal with Greek philosophy, over 2,000 years, the pagan philosophers have criticized each other. And what was their criticism? It's logically inconsistent, incoherent. Now, did they finally say, all right, you've got to have Christianity? No. They are so completely in the grip of the dialectic that they believe with all of their heart that they must account for both elements, universality and particularity. And what does postmodernism do? It fights the universality pole and the influence of the universality pole. But they never deny that the universality pole is there. So whatever they do in order to get rid of the universality pole, even logical inconsistency, is fine. Because they are so gripped. They have 666 vision. It's the number of a man, the book of Revelation. Universality is the stuff of which reality is made. Not God, who displays both, is not the final stuff, if you wish. But that is the stuff. So when they see one part of the stuff being obnoxious, then they use the other side to kill it in case of need. And they're willing to be incoherent. That doesn't make any difference. When people complain about Eastern religions, you are mystic, you're incoherent. I say, you don't understand. This dialectic victimizes them and grips them. And they honestly believe that that is the stuff of reality. And they must work out a way to put them together. And everybody has failed. But now they are going to succeed. If you believe that that is the stuff, then you are staying within those parameters. You understand? And if you say there is no such thing as absolute truth, I hate the universal, and that is the absolute truth, that's logically incoherent. He said, you don't understand. My crusade is against universality, and I will use any kind of means to destroy it, even if it's universality. And it doesn't bother them, for sure. It doesn't bother them. You get it? They're all like Nehemiah. They're not like you and me, who read it and then we go home and have our root beer. Sometimes we forget our root. All right? As I told you earlier. All right? You see? No, no, no. Marx, my dear young man, has it over you in terms of common grace, because he was a man with a mission. I think you're right. But you also may be lukewarm. And God says, I'll spew you out of my mouth. And you can join him because he goes after the wrong thing. But at least it will be more tolerable for Karl Marx than for Dr. Henry. Because he knows everything, but he is as lukewarm as you can get. He never gets hot under the collar. He never gets emotional about it. As long as he can be the king's cupbearer, everything is fine. You see? You get it, boy? You gotta understand these people, there's explosives in them. And they're willing to cut their nose to spite their face. Now, that's stupid. Ha, 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 ha. Well, I could say to you, be yourself. I said to somebody, but he couldn't. He was a nobody. I've got to step on your tail, Mr. Gutierrez. You know what I mean? I love the shining path, common grace, galore. But they're heading in the wrong direction. They have a zeal. Now, I'm not saying that I put you up as an example. No. The only one example is not the common, is not the shining path as many Christians do. Ah, they have zeal. Ah, we can learn something from them. No. Christ is zeal beyond you can ever imagine. You don't follow the shining path. You follow Christ. And the funny thing is, those guys, they steal what Christ is, and they're going places for the time being. And you see Christ, and you... and you put your tables up in the temple, and you sell your wares. So I'm not lauding them. But the world is a lot smarter than those Christians. You get a point? The moment you say, we can learn so much from them, you're already behind the eight ball. Let me make one mistake before I forget. And you keep your hands up so I don't forget you, alright? And I remember you. You see, what it is, you see, that common grace is a very crude example. I have to be ashamed of myself, but I do it anyway. The common grace is like seeds in horse manure. Now the birds are able to pick up the seeds, and they don't swallow the manure. The birds are Christians, you see. True Christians who understand, and they pick out the seeds, but they leave the manure behind. Most of them are Christians. They swallow the manure plus the seed, and it kills them. And I have a star witness. This is the history of Christianity. Every Christian school has gone down the tubes. Now we are working on that in our faculty. And I tell them, if you do not see that common grace, that antithesis trumps common grace, as one of my colleagues said, if you don't see it, Ichabod over the, we may go our way for a little longer, but ultimately it is swallow us up. And now this dear young lady.
The people who have the common grace, how do you take that when you're trying to show them special grace? Do you have to destroy their common grace first, or do you work it into it? How do you show them the special grace from the common grace?
It's very beautiful. You show them that they implode, like Zechariah says. You see? But then you say, first of all, you must have their emotions. You're not going to debate them unless they insist. Let me put it this way. If you meet a person like this, what I did with the Buddhists and the Muslims and the Hindus, you see, I said to them, none of the Hindus, because it was my first try, and I did not really get a handle on it. It was a wonderful discussion with the Hindus, but it was less than a draw on my part. But with the Buddha, with the Muslims, I learned a lot. It was more than a draw. All right, because I became better in my methodology. No. If there's a person whom you want to talk to, you say, okay, get their emotions, and they say, okay, tell me what you believe. I tell you what I believe. All right, and then you can criticize me. And if they say okay, you put it all on the table. This is what their views are, this is what your views is, and you begin with the gospel, and then you say to them, he said, now you have a few problems, as I said to the Muslim, you have problems because you can never find the equilibrium between the one and the many, and or in and under authority in your system. You can never find it. That's because, unless your heart breaks before God, you will never find it. Well, I try to give an answer to that, but it depends upon the individual. Paul says, okay, I'll start with common grace. You worship God, so you worship, and that is interesting. But then he ends up with the antithesis, you have to repent. Because whom you worship is not the God of Scripture. You see what I mean? So if you take a look at Acts 17, he started with common grace, and he ends up with antithesis. But if you sit around a table, then you may do it. Then you may say, okay, let's put all the cards on the table. You, your cards, I, my card. And ultimately, you're going to get to the same point. I said, there's only one way to get out of your problem, and that is that you repent. I'm making myself... Well, we still have the half semester to go, so I'll keep that in mind, all right? So, first of all, you show... While you can show them that they have wrong implications in their thinking, you can never send them in the right direction. All right? Transcendent criticism, you remember, Amanda, that you gave transcendent criticism, cannot send them in the right direction either. Then you put your view over against the other. No, you are, ladies and gentlemen, transcendental. You go to the origin, the rebel origin. And it's rebel catch 22. And it's rebel consequences. Laura, page 71. You go to the rebel origin, the rebel catch 22, and the rebel consequences. And that's what Zacharias is doing. They're rebels, they're in catch 22, they cannot go one way and the other at the same time, and the consequences are terrible. With regard to the biblical fruit of faith, you showed them the personal and corporate shalom by means of the presentation of the ever-broadening circles of such shalom, in contrast with the fallout of the dialectic, love, holiness, joy, peace, harmony, and prosperity in Christ and through the Spirit. That should be emphasized. And then, of course, in order to do that, you need the origin, nature, need, and fruit of the new heart and regeneration to be set forth lucidly and cogently. And the same should be done pertaining to the new record in justification and the new life in sanctification. Now, Laura has had a very good question. How does it become in a concrete fashion? And I'll keep this in mind when I say, yeah, this is how you can do it. And then we'll make the next step. What are the tools? All truth, biblical, rational, factual, is a personal truth. You must do it carefully, but you must do it also relentlessly. You must drive it home. But Laura, it comes back and again upon the question, do you have their emotions? If you have their emotions, then they are willing to listen to the gospel from beginning to end. And then you say, because we listen to the gospel, this is the fruit that we find in our lives, and we are not dialectic, we are not incoherent, and of course this is what is right. In Zacharias and also in frame, we are not logically incoherent, we are not factually non-correspondent, and we are not experientially falling apart. You see, we have it over them. But then if you then try to say that our rational truth gains the day, then of course you are wrong again. Because then you try to prove absolutely, and at worst you get to probability and you mire down in that. You see, so you cannot go that route either, but you say, hey, we don't have your problem. Because we have self-denial, and we have self-sacrifice, and we have submission. And I understand, sir, if you don't have that, the sound that you produce is as hollow as you can be. You have to put yourself in your gospel gun. As that young lady said, but Jesus is in my heart. And he looks, you remember? He looked at the girl from the profile and said, that's the truth. And that broke him. The method, the key to the kingdom. And this is what I insist on. You must be discriminatory and applicatory. Non-Christians should have no doubt about their eternal plight at the conclusion of the presentation, while Christians should have no doubt about their shortcomings before God by the time you're finished. Now, how are you going to do it precisely? You cannot walk in a transcendent fashion. You're hellbound. I mean, that doesn't go over. All right? The Lord Jesus says, call your husband. And what does he do? I have no husband. There you are. He said, that's right, lady, because the husband, the man with whom you live is not your husband. There's the root. Justification. Nicodemus, he has her emotions. Unless you're born again, you cannot see the kingdom. I'm afraid to say, you're so wonderful to give me all those wonderful accolades, but you're still blind. You see? It looks like you see, but you're blind. You get it? Of course I'm a teacher who comes from God, but you're still blind. Because you don't see I'm a God who came to teach. Boomer at the well. You're ornery. You're rebellious. But then you are nice. Give me that water. Call your husband. Now, I do not know what's going on in the life of a person because I'm not Jesus. But I tell you, I was once went to evangelize, and the guy in the church who did the bookkeeping for our evangelism phoned me just before I left. He said, Henry, I want to tell you, it just came to my attention that the guy whom you're going to visit is not married to the woman with whom she lives, with whom he lives. So I began to tell him the story of the woman at the well. You see, after I made my presentation first, and I said, well, there's a variety of possibilities. I use Nicodemus. I need a woman at the well. And of course, when I asked him to come across, he said, may I have a word with you in private tomorrow for breakfast? I said, sure. And then he said, well, I am not married to that lady. And of course, I pricked his conscience, but not in a transcendent fashion. I just worked with him and pricked it. And then he responded. And the next day, he was talking about, I said, how many do you have brothers and sisters? How many are married? I said, that's kind of funny. You have two brothers and sisters. You have two married. Yeah, you have the three of you. He said, well, I'm not married. Oh. in other words, you let him place this before you. So you, and then you're discriminatory and applicatory. Discrimination is toward unbelievers, and application is toward believers. But by the time there's something that is not pleasing to God, that it becomes very clear. And then you do not, your aim is not agreement, as if the intellectual level is ultimate, but the aim is repentance. Every time, all the time, and faith. Repentance without faith is despair, and faith without repentance is presumption. You see, so you must always preach the gospel. The gospel, the gospel. What is the focus? Christ is Lord and Savior. It's very interesting in the final moment yesterday when I completed this this wonderful paper, quote unquote, all of a sudden it dawned on me when Christ apologia centers upon, guess what? Christ. Christ uses Christ in his apologia. I had never seen it before like that. Well, that's interesting, right? Smile. You know, smile a little bit. Once in a while, give me an encouragement. You know, because every once in a while, because this old man needs love too. You see? You think, and beyond that, of course not. Christ uses Christ. Ha, 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 ha. Peter uses Christ. Paul uses Christ. And we are pre-evangelistic. Oh. It doesn't make sense, does it? And that's why we're not making any headway. That's why we're losing the battle. Don't ever think that we're not losing the battle, ladies and gentlemen. No. We win battles, but we're losing the war. It's even better. We win many battles. Praise the Lord. But we're losing the war. Right? Right or wrong? Nehemiah? Oh my God. Come on and pray with me. It's Tuesday at 6 a.m. Well, that's too early. And I heard people say that to me. I said, well, I see myself in that, you see, so I'm no longer boiling mad. At my age, you never become boiling mad anymore, not until after you nearly go down in an airplane. You know, that I knew that when I nearly went down to that airplane, and of course, I think you know it, at 10,000 feet in 2 minutes, and the pilot said between 2 and 5 seconds later, and I wouldn't have been able to bring the airplane under control anymore. You see, I knew that there were some accounts that were a little too long. And that was not a pleasant experience. You see, you no longer become boiling mad, but you still must become boiling sad. All right? And if you don't become boiling sad when you see it all, so every time, ladies and gentlemen, you have a joy, there must be some nostalgia. The joy in creation. But what is the nostalgia? What is the nostalgia? It used to be paradise. Understand? Now, if it's only say, oh, paradise, this is terrible, then you're displeasing to God. You say, we drink in this whole creation. Then you start drinking the dregs too. But again, 100% plus 100%. I hope you always be nostalgic. Even if you're married, enjoy your wife all the days of your meaningless life. That's Ecclesiastes 9 verse 9. Did you know that? Ecclesiastes 9 verse 9. Write it down. Enjoy your wife. Joy. All the days of your meaningless life. Nostalgia. Get it? You like that? The way he smiles. The light just went off. Okay. So the avenue is the call to faith and repentance. The summary, a biblical apologetic should be perceptively, knowledgeably, truthfully, lovingly, compassionately, courageously, fearlessly, methodically, and uncompromisingly confrontational. That's the apologist of the according to Scripture. Now, what is your authority? It's always truth, 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 truth. All truth is God's truth, even in the unbeliever, and but stolen goods. Here, they steal a wonderful television, and guess where you end up? Oh, I love this. I never thought of it before. I love this. Here you have a television that you stole, where you end up? In jail. Ha 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 ha. Where do the unbeliever end up? In jail. Where does Plato end up? In jail. Where does Aristotle end up? In jail. And we can learn so much from the man. Now that's stupid. You understand? And then stop there. You get it? You get it? They end up in jail. In eternal hell. And we don't even have the compassion to say, why didn't you repent to go to Jesus? We are the tail. We are not the head, we are the tail. You go in the break, ask yourself how many percent of the time you have been the tail. Huh? You go listen to television, and you're always the tail. The television, you know that after, you know when you die when you're 80 years old, how many times, statistically, how many hours you have spent behind a boob tube? 15 and a half years. Now that's what you call tailing. Tailgating. I love you. I love you. Because that doesn't come out of me, that comes out of you. What is the conclusion? Well, there's a big debate whether you're circular or linear. Sproul says you cannot be circular because that's not honest in your debate with the other people. That's why you have the neutral territory. The presuppositionalist says, hey, everybody is circular, so don't try to tell me that I must be linear while everybody is circular. The rationalist always starts with irrationalism. His irrationalist always is irrationalism. You know, you see, how do we know that? Because if you're gripped by the dialectic, you're gripped by the one, or you're gripped by the many. And the one is your point of departure, or the many is your point of departure, and you end up where you started, right? Postmodernity. Is that, I'll run a few minutes over time, but that's okay, because this is the last statement. As that referee said, the three referees, I call it as they are, modernist. Totally modernity, absolute truth. The guy said, that's a little too much, not absolute proof. I call it, as I see it, probability. Huh? And the postmodernist says, you're both of your rocker. I said, what do you mean? Until I call them, there ain't no balls and there ain't no strikes, you see. That is pure particularity. Now, Christians say you got to be either linear or circular. I say, forget it. Not pre-evangelistically linear, not non-evangelistic circular, but evangelistic, you transcend it. Because you don't go after the mind. You go after the brain. Now, the person who is framed says you've got to be as broadly circular as you can. That's the only hope you have, the hope that you make an impact. Well, I much rather have be broadly circular than linear. So if you compare the evidentialist with the presuppositionalist, the presuppositionist has head and shoulders. But in the final analysis, they're kissing cousins. The very terms linear and circular betray that the protagonist are still operating on the level of the intellect only. The intellect is the grand prize. A biblically informed apologetics transcends the dilemma. It locks in on the heart, seeks it out, and challenges it with the truth of God. It doesn't restrict itself to imminent criticism. By itself, this stays too much on the surface. Neither does it confine itself to transcendent criticism. By itself, this displays too much detachment. It is transcendental. In its approach, it truly communicates. It lays bare the deepest movements of the heart in both a gentle and surgical fashion. Then it applies the cure in a person-variable manner. See, Laura? Person-variable. This requires painstaking involvement, fervent prayer, careful diagnosis, and skillful treatment. In short, it's hard work. In the final analysis, the transcendental apologist will not be satisfied until and unless it is evident to unbelievers that he or she loves them more than they love themselves. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is what you call TA, not TM, Transcendental Meditation, but Transcendental Apologetics. Think about it. Write your paper. Also, interact with the problem of evil. And if you get this in your system, ladies and gentlemen, a little test here and there is dwarfed by. If you're a transcendental apologist, then God will teach you all the details. And in terms of Laura's, her question is, how do you do it actually in a hand-to-hand combat? We are going to get back to that, Lord willing, again and again. And when I have new brainstorms, then I will let you know, and if you get new brainstorms, you'll let us know as well, okay? All right, let me pray. Our Father, I thank you so much for these fine folks. I love you for giving them to me for a semester. And I thank you that it is a joy of my heart that has come through prayer, through your grace and your mercy, and when I talk about hard work, we recognize that we can no longer stay on the sidelines. We have to get into the swing of things. Right in the middle, in the battlefield, I ask you that you will give that to us. And when we are in the battlefield, we must want to be effective. And then prayer, of course, becomes very important. We cannot just be faithful, because a desire to be effective is part of our faithfulness, and it will drive us. We will be driven like Nehemiah, like Daniel, like Anna. Oh my God, like Anna. And I plead with you, O God, that you will, that this will come into our lives, and that we will be able to, where we are, raise the temperature of the church just a mite, year after year. So that, Father, we will be able to turn the tables, and not be in a down-going line, but that it will be an up-going line. That is our plea, in Jesus' name. Amen.